When was the last time you felt good? I mean, really good, like divine good. In your body and in your heart. Maybe it's been in the last few minutes with these wonderful words from Hafiz and this amazing music that we have been blessed with this morning. Maybe it's something else, a tender moment with a child, exhilaration playing a sport, cuddling a fluffy pet. Take a minute to find that moment. Close your eyes if you like. Breathe in and out. Notice what it feels like. Warmth, excitement. Is there some sadness mixed in? Where in your body do you feel it? Hold that feeling for a minute. Breathe in and out. Before you let that moment go, did you have an instant when you were searching for your moment of saying to yourself, nope, that one doesn't count. Keep looking, find another one. Tuck that answer away for later. You can open your eyes now. Hafiz tells us to find God everywhere, all around us, and trust that our bodies, our senses, are actually capable of good worship decisions. That in following our hearts, we can discern what is most important to us and how to honor it. Essentially, that pleasure can be a guide to what is good. I don't know about you, though, but my body tells me pretty often that what we really need is another cookie. I'm suspicious of whether my body, heart, intuition, whatever you want to call it, is really that trustworthy. So I want to talk about three challenges to following the guidance of our bodies toward the divine. The first is that we're socialized to believe that pleasure equals bad. The second is the connection between pleasure and injustice. And the third is that it just takes practice. Hafiz was not shy about criticizing mainstream thought that won't admit pleasure as a guide to the right kind of good, the divine kind. He sees this socialization as unfortunate and limiting. In his poem, Tiny Gods, Hafiz rather graphically lists some of the things we may be taught are not divine. Some gods say, the tiny ones, I am not here in your vibrant, moist lips that need to beach themselves upon the golden shore of a naked body. Some gods say, I am not the sacred yearning in the unrequited soul. I am not the blushing cheek of every star and planet. I am not the applauding chef of those precious secretions that can distill the whole mind into a perfect wincing jewel, if only for a moment. Nor do I reside in every pile of warm, sweet dung born of the earth's gratuity. Some gods say, the ones we need to hang, your mouth is not designed to know his. Love was not born to consume the luminous realms. Dear ones, beware of the tiny gods frightened men create to bring an anesthetic relief to their sad days. For Hafiz, music, dancing, expressing our gender, sex and romance, and even heartache can be paths to God. Perhaps I can have that cookie after all. At least every once in a while. UU theologian, the Reverend Dr. Tandeka, offers in the tradition of psychoanalysis that the breakdown between our body and mind that tells us pleasure is bad often happens early in our lives. We make some kind of connection with another person that we find pleasurable, but which is identified by our caretakers as bad and wrong. We then learn to follow the rules rather than trusting our own human ability to connect. She explores in depth the example of racial trauma in the process of Euro-Americans becoming white. Rather than being born white, she argues, at some point early in our lives, most of us have an experience where race trumps pleasure. For example, being told which friends can come to a birthday party. That experience keeps us from being our most fulfilled selves and leaves us with a sense of shame around race that makes it hard to talk about for the rest of our lives. It's hard work to rebuild that connection with our bodies, but it can be worthwhile, especially because it allows more genuine connection with each other. There are examples in our own theological history of leaders connecting with their body. Our Universalist forebear, Hosea Ballou, describes powerfully how bodily sensation informs his core beliefs. He said, "That which more than anything else contributed to turn my thoughts seriously towards the belief of universalism was the ardent desire with which I found myself exercised that sinners might be brought to repentance and salvation. I found it utterly impossible to bring my feelings to consent to the doctrine of eternal reprobation, and I was compelled either to allow that such feelings were sinful or that my heavenly Father, in giving them to me, had implanted an evidence in favor of the salvation of all men, the force of which I found no means to resist." In other words, Ballou was a universalist because it just felt wrong to worship a God who would send people to hell. Tandeka points out, in bringing up this example, that Ballou had a warm, nurturing upbringing that allowed him to stay in touch with his intuition and let pleasure guide his theology, helping lead a theological revolution. Many of us are not so lucky, and all of us are impacted by trauma in various ways and degrees. Denying or being denied the truth of our body is trauma. It's a breakdown of wholeness. That kind of trauma builds on other kinds of trauma that we experience, emotional, physical, as a result of being human in this world. And that brings us to matters of justice. By realizing our body's truth, we are better able to recognize the ways other bodies are traumatized and deprived of pleasure. And if we can find commonality in our yearning for wholeness, this yearning can be a bridge across the trauma that so often divides us. In thinking about pleasure as a bridge, let's start on the one-on-one level. One of my most powerful formative UU experiences was in the About Your Sexuality course that I took in about eighth grade with my Sunday school classmates. It's a precursor to what we now know as the Our Whole Lives, or OWL, curriculum, which we offer frequently here, tailored to various age groups, including adults. OWL starts from the principle that sexuality is a good part of the human experience. That's an idea that resonates with the poem we just heard. Another foundational principle is that people engage in healthy sexual behavior for a variety of reasons, including to share pleasure. OWL teaches that each person's pleasure is wrapped up in other people's and offers responsible ways to make decisions and communicate with our sexual partners, the people who are often among the closest to us. In this way, it not only enriches our intimate relationships, like seriously, you should get like a badge to put on your dating profile when you complete OWL. But it also prepares us to scale up, to caring about the joy and satisfaction of other people in our lives, and eventually to groups we see as different or outside of our community. Owl also names that sexuality in our society is damaged by violence, exploitation, alienation, dishonesty, abuse of power, and the treatment of persons as objects. Through a healthy relationship to sexual pleasure, we also start to learn about ways trauma, particularly systematized trauma, interferes with our ability to experience goodness. In this case, it's the oppression of patriarchy, but it could be racial, as we discussed earlier. And if you want to dig in on the relationship between money and pleasure, come back here to the sanctuary at 12:30 today for Dr. Jason Delaney's Worthy Beyond Worth adult religious education class. Self-proclaimed pleasure activist Adrian Marie Brown has some helpful reflections connecting pleasure and oppression. She says, pleasure activism is about learning what it means to be satisfiable, to generate from within and from between us an abundance from which we can all have enough. Part of the reason so few of us have a healthy relationship with pleasure is because a small minority of our species hoards the excess of resources, creating a false scarcity, and then trying to sell us joy, sell us back to ourselves. Pleasure is not one of the spoils of capitalism. It is what our bodies, our human systems, are structured for. It is the aliveness and awakening, the gratitude and humility, the joy and celebration of being miraculous. Gratitude and humility, joy and celebration, miraculous. Sounds like spiritual work to me. Indeed, it takes spiritual practice and maybe some therapy if you follow Tandeka's line of psychoanalysis, and it can be hard. Here are a few more of Adrian Marie Brown's tips for responsibly following pleasure as a guide to what is good, with some elaboration from me. We become what we practice. Think back to your moment of pleasure from when you closed your eyes a few minutes ago. Remember that feeling in your body? Get to know that feeling. Feel it more often. What you pay attention to grows. One way to start listening to your own body is meditative practice. But even if you're not a meditator, maybe you can create new habits by journaling, reflecting with a friend, even putting a reminder in your Google Calendar to make some time for yourself. Quieting our minds can make room for our bodies to send us a message. It can also help us sort through all the confusion of oppressive socialization. If you second-guessed your pleasure moment a minute ago, reflection may help you either figure out how to embrace that pleasure or decide to grow in a different direction. Third, she says, make justice and liberation feel good. We did that last weekend here with Dolly Parton. Go march in the Pride Parade. Bring your creativity to the revolution. Maybe sign up for the next OWL class. In this moment, she says, we must prioritize the pleasure of those most impacted by oppression. Acknowledging the truth of our bodies, even when that truth is just straight up pain, is a step toward wholeness. Witnessing someone else's pain is something we can do for each other in our darkest moments when there's not much else we can do. Show up for each other and practice recognizing that even when someone is very different from you, they may be yearning for some kind of wholeness. A few more quick tips that I can't skip over. Yes is the way. Your no makes the way for your yes. Being able to say no makes yes a choice. Moderation is key. Remember, pleasure is about being satisfied and satisfiable. Finally, she says, try on the idea that when I am happy, it is good for the world. Whoa. And here we are, back at Hafiz, finding our way to the divine good through joy. A theology rooted in yearning for pleasure may bring us more pleasure, more music and dancing, healthy sex, gender expression, animal cuddles, more beautiful nature. It also challenges us to find pleasure in unexpected ways, in work that makes us alive, in learning, amidst trauma, in life decisions, and in connection with others. Here's an example of a recent way that trying this theology on pushed me through a difficult personal encounter. Recently, a devout Christian asked me how I came around to my religious beliefs. I could feel her reaching for a connection with me, but I pushed back, maybe channeling some trauma of Unitarian Universalism being judged by Christianity. I needed to know more about what was behind her question. I wasn't able to unearth it. I gave a superficial answer, and it continued to bother me. As I digested the encounter with a mentor, I realized, one, how difficult it was to focus on the good part, the desire for connection, when my concern about judgment got in the way, and two, that my theology calls me to do so. What if I took a risk thinking about other ways the conversation could have gone? What if I opened up about my own experience of judgment, my being judged and judging others, even when I really didn't want or mean to? Would we have come to a more satisfying, deeper understanding and connection? Next time, maybe by focusing on the goodness we are both striving for, I will be able to create more of it. Pleasure is a powerful and worthwhile guide, but a theology of pleasure requires rigorous spiritual work. It won't always feel divine, but sometimes it will, and practicing will feel really good. Let's let the words of Hafiz hold us on our journey towards what our bodies know is good. You have not danced so badly, my dear, trying to hold hands with the beautiful one. You have waltzed with great style, my sweet, crushed angel, to have ever neared God's heart at all. Our partner is notoriously difficult to follow, and even his best musicians are not always easy to hear. So what if the music has stopped for a while? So what if the price of admission to the divine is out of reach tonight? So what, my sweetheart, if you lack the ante to gamble for real love? The mind and the body are famous for holding the heart ransom. But Hafiz knows the beloved's eternal habits. Have patience, for he will not be able to resist your longings and charms for long. You have not danced so badly, my dear, trying to kiss the magnificent one. You have actually waltzed with tremendous style, my sweet, oh my sweet, crushed angel. Amen.